Hello and welcome back to Pharma E-Class. I am Anindo Goswami and we were discussing liquid mixers. Now come to a very important topic, vortexing. Due to high speed of the propellers, vortexing and finally aeration may occur, that is air may get entrapped and which may be difficult to remove from the product, and this air entrapment may cause oxidation in certain cases. So these are the diagrammatic representation of vortexing, where the impeller draws the liquid and air towards it, thus causing vortex, and this phenomenon is called as vortexing. So general tendencies, what are the general tendency where the vortex can form? If the shaft is placed symmetrically in the tank, that is a classic design of liquid mixer. If we can visualize, classic design means there is a mixing tank and the shaft impeller is put at the center only. So that is a symmetrically it is being kept. So that there is a tendency can come that vortexing may be formed. Else, when the blades in the turbines are arranged perpendicularly to the central shaft, that is when the blades are just in a perpendicular fashion, then also it can be formed. Then at a very high impeller speeds, when the speed of the impeller is quite high, then also vortexing can be presented. And if we are working in unbaffled tanks where there are no partitions, where the foam or the air entrapment will collide and will break. So in unbaffled tanks, this formation of or entrapment of air is quite common. So what is the disadvantage? Why do we don't want vortex to form? Vortex formation reduces mixing intensity by reducing velocity of the impeller relative to the surrounding fluid. That is one of the problems or disadvantages. Next, when vortex reaches the impeller, air from the surface of the liquid are drawn and air bubbles are produced. That is a problem, that is a disadvantage. Air bubbles in the fluid can create uneven loading of the impeller bed. That is also a disadvantage. And the entrapped air causes oxidation of the substances in most of the cases. Now, how to avoid vortexing? We cannot change the entire design, but we have to do some modifications practically in the impeller, in the positioning of the impellers, and it has been seen to get good results, or vortexing has been reduced. So what are the strategies to avoid vortexing? First, the propeller should be deep into the liquid. Yes, when the propeller is kept not at the center or not at the horizon or not at the surface, but deep inside the liquid, then it is being seen the vortexing is being can be avoided. Next, symmetry should be avoided. Symmetry, that which we had seen in the previous slides, the cause of vortexing is symmetrical positioning of the impeller. So symmetry should be avoided. How can symmetry be avoided? A, the propeller shaft may be offset from the center. Look at this, the propeller shaft is not at the center, but it is at the off center, somewhat at a distance in the center. Next, the propeller shaft may be mounted at an angle to the vertical wall of the container. Yes, it is being mounted at a particular angle. That is also another arrangement. Next, the shaft may enter from the side of the vessel. Just look at the diagram and check. It is very easy. Next, or a vessel or other than cylinder may also be used. Yes, we can also use any other cylinder of like that, which is not exactly like this particular tank design. A push-pull type of propeller may be used, in which two propellers of same pitch are mounted on the same shaft so that the rotating effects are in opposite direction and cancel each other, exactly like figure E, where there are in this impeller shaft there are two impeller devices, there are two in more than one impeller blades, and the vortexing created by one can be nullified by the other. So the push-pull type of propeller may be used where two propellers of opposite pitch can be attached. That is also another arrangement which can be done. And one or more type of baffles can also be used. Like for example, where the vertical strips are attached to the center of the mixing tank, where this vertical shaped baffles can also be arranged. So let us come to the factors influencing mixing of liquids in mixing tanks. So what are the factors which is governing this particular process? First and foremost, the materials related factor, that is the properties of the liquid which are to be mixed. Like for example, their density, their viscosity, their miscibility pattern, characteristics, all. Next, the equipment related factor, that is the propeller shape or shape of the impeller, like propeller type, straight, vertical, curved or pitched. What is the shape of the impeller? Next, the position of the impeller, that is central, off center, side entry, vertical or it is in inclined position. Shape and size of the container, that is presence or absence of baffle. This is a very important factor. Next, the cost of the equipment and its maintenance. Next, there are some process related factors, maybe like a speed of rotation of the impeller, the time required for the mixing, that is the batch size, the power which is consumed and the ease of operation. So these all factors in bold which we are seeing, they are the mainly influencing which type of mixing tank or what arrangement or what propeller type we have to take. We have to take paddles or we can take impellers or we can take propellers or we can take any sorts of turbines. So which type of raw material, which type of material we are mixing, which type of liquids we are going to throw, that is also important. Let us come to the mixing of immiscible liquids. So mixing of immiscible liquid is another important phenomenon, particularly for biphasic systems like emulsions. So in that case, these are mainly used for the manufacture of emulsions by certain equipments known as emulsifiers. And further to decrease the particle size or the globule size of the oil water system, that is emulsion system, we use homogenizers for finer emulsions. So the basic machines or basic equipments which are used for the mixing of immiscible solids are namely Rapasonic homogenizer or the classic homogenizer, it is like that, the Silverson mixer emulsifier and colloid mill. This is a classic ultrasonic emulsifier or Rapasonic homogenizer. Come to the principle. When a liquid is subjected to ultrasonic vibration, alternate regions of compression and rarefaction are produced in the liquid. And the cavities are formed in the regions of rarefaction, which subsequently collapse in the regions of compression, which results for generation of greater forces which is required for emulsification. Now in case of emulsification, we have to mix two dissimilar phases. Two phases, like for example oil and water, and they are completely of different characteristics, like maybe of different specific gravity, different polarity, different densities also. So we need high or greater force for the emulsification, and that is been generated in a Rapasonic homogenizer. Let us come to the construction. Quite a simple construction is like that, and this particular device is fixed with the mixing tank, where we have to take to both the phases which are to be mixed or emulsified. It consists of a pump driven by a motor. This is a motor and the pump is driven by that motor. It is connected to inlet tube and an outlet tube. Head consisting of a flat jet for a liquid inlet. Facing the jet, a thin blade is present which vibrates at its natural frequency. So this is the shaft, and this particular is the Rapasonic emulsifier, and it is dipped into the mixing tank where it is being done. Now, what are the advantages of Rapasonic homogenizer? It can be used for batch processes or even for a continuous process. In a fixed mixing tank, we can use it a batch process, but in larger tanks, when we can go on adding the samples, the test liquids, then we can use it a continuous process. It has the capacity to produce dispersed globule of 1 micron size. The method is highly effective to decrease the globule size, reduce concentration of emulsions is sufficient. That is important. The capacity of the mixing ranges from around 20 to 500 liters per minute, which is quite good. It is suitable for thermolabile substances as heat is not generated during mixing. So quite advantageous for the rapeseolic homogenizer, and it is routinely used in pharmaceutical industries for the emulsification purposes. Coming to the disadvantage of rapeseolic homogenizers, that it can be, it is ideal for low viscous liquids. This is another classic mixer emulsifier used in for the preparation of emulsions, that is Silverson mixer emulsifier. Quite the same attachment in like the previous one. This is the attachment which is important, and this is diagrammatically represented like this, a magnified diagram. So it produces intense shearing forces and turbulences by the use of high speed rotors. So high speed rotors are used in this, and that the resultant is high speed shearing forces due to high speed rotors. Circulation of material takes place through the head of the suction produced in the inlet of the bottom of the head. A number of perforations are there, so a suction type of action is being produced, and this particular inlet, this particular attachment is being dipped into the mixing device where the sample is being kept for emulsification. Circulation of the material ensures rapid breakdown of the dispersed liquid into smaller globules. So the basic process for emulsification, for the preparation of emulsion, as you must be knowing, to mix the two phases of oil and liquid, where we have to disperse them into smaller globules to avoid any disadvantage, that is to avoid any breaking of the phase. So we should go for smaller globule sizes. So that's being done by a Silverson mixer emulsifier. It consists of long supporting columns and a central portion. The central portion consists of a shaft which is connected to a motor at one end and other to the other head. So it is connected with the motor, this attachment, and the head carries turbine blades. So inside this particular attachment, turbine blades are there. As we have already known what turbine blades are, they are hemispherical or curved type of blades, which is essential for breaking up the globule sizes. The head carries turbine blades, and blades are surrounded by a mesh or screen or sieve, which is further enclosed by a covering that have openings. So in the next slide it may be much more clear. Yes, this is how it is being done. So this is the outer covering, which is containing some perforations. Inside, then this particular screen or mesh is there, and inside again there is the turbine blade. So the total attachment is like this. The first outermost layer is this circular head, this one, which is having the perforations. Next, inside the circular head, there is the circular mesh or the screen. And inside this mesh is the main attachment, that is the turbine blade, which is actually doing the job of decreasing the globule size or mixing or homogenizing. And this particular attachment entirely is connected with the central rotating shaft. So come to the uses. Yes, for the preparation of emulsions and creams of fine particle sizes. Advantageous in the aspect of it is available in different sizes to handle the liquids ranging from a few milliliters to several thousand liters. This capacity should be improved, so it is coming in that particular size ranges, so that we can handle from a liquid from the batch with up to few milliliters to several thousand liters also. Can be used for batch operations as well as for continuous operations. And coming to the disadvantages, occasionally there is a chance of the clogging of the pores of the mesh or the screen which is inside this particular attachment, which is visible from the outside, that this mesh can sometimes get clogged if the particle size of the solid which is being dispersed in either the liquid phase or the oil phase. So it can happen. So that is the basic disadvantage. Come to the third or the final mixing device for semi-solids, that is colloid mill. Colloid mill will again study in size reduction machine. It is a mill. Mills are generally used for size reduction. So this is a typical diagram, and this is also used for mixing of semi-solids containing high proportion of solids or containing high proportion of dispersed solids, particularly in case of pastes or maybe for in case of your emulsions also which contain solid. So basically the basic principle, what is the basic principle? The passage of the mixed phases of an emulsion formula between the stator and a high speed rotor revolving at speeds of 2000 to 18,000 rpm. So from a very low speed to a quite a high speed, and this is the stator position and this is the rotor position, and these are the grinding surface available. So feed comes like this, and the action between the rotor and the stator, the emulsion mixer which is placed between the rotor and the stator, is subjected to a tremendous force or shear which affects a fine dispersion of about uniform size, and that is its working. Yes, the emulsion mixture while passing between the rotor and the stator is subjected to a tremendous shear or force, and that shearing action, that force affects to results into a fine dispersion of uniform size. These shearing forces are applied in the colloid mill, usually raise the temperature within the emulsion. So the coolant is being definitely we have to use, which is used to absorb the particular heat to prevent any disadvantageous nature of the mill or to prevent any decomposition of the solid due to the heating. So these are the coolants. Or cold liquid is being entered so that it don't have the heat which is being generated due to this process of continuous shearing between the rotor and the stator. To avoid that cooling, to avoid that heating up, coolants are used. Coolant outlet is this and coolant inlet is this. So coolant liquid is being entered in this, and this is the position of the coolant. Coolant on both sides. So the stator position and the rotor position and the development of the shearing action, that is the main working of the colloid mill. Uses and advantages: very high shearing forces can be generated and very fine particles can be obtained, particularly used for emulsions as well as suspensions containing poorly wetted solid. As I've already told you, for it is also useful for viscous emulsions also, where there are quite a good amount of particles, as well as for suspensions where are there also some dispersed particles. So it is quite advantageous for suspensions as well as for emulsions. Next come to the selection criteria for liquid mixer, that is the mixing of semi-solids or mixing of the mixing of liquids of maybe miscible type or immiscible type. Let us check the basic selection criteria, that is physical properties of the materials to be mixed, like its density, miscibility, everything. The economic considerations regarding the processing, that is the time required for mixing and the power expenditure, the cost of the equipment and its maintenance, and the viscosity and the density of the fluids that is to be mixed for the type of the flow that can be produced.